Good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Silas Farley, and I have the privilege of serving as Dean of the Trudel Zipper Dance Institute here at Colburn. And on behalf of my Associate Dean, Darlene Callahan, our entire faculty, staff, and musicians, it's a delight to welcome you to our first main stage performance of the 22-23 season, See the Music, Hear the Dance. See the Music, Hear the Dance is one of the most famous ideas from George Balanchine, the legendary teacher and choreographer who founded both the School of American Ballet and New York City Ballet. And this idea, See the Music, Hear the Dance, is a way of describing a kind of visualization of music through high-definition dancing. And that was a foundational idea of the American ballet tradition that Balanchine helped establish. And I say that because here at Colburn, our dance training in all genres of ballet and tap and modern is a continuation of that musically driven dance training tradition. And my immediate predecessor in this role was a former New York City ballet dancer named Jennifer Ringer, and she instituted this See the Music, Hear the Dance event. And every year it's a wonderful opportunity for musicians from our Colburn Conservatory to collaborate with leading dancers in the field who are also friends of Colburn. And tonight we're in for quite a treat because we have with us two extraordinary guest dancers from the Houston Ballet, Karina González Edwards and Harper Waters, whom you just saw dance so beautifully. And we are grateful to Lee Chopa, Dean of our conservatory, and to the faculty who've helped prepare Gabe Christ on the piano, and then later in the evening, Olivia Marks on cello, and Minhei Choi, one of our faculty members, on piano. So it's gonna be a great evening of collaboration. And I just wanna thank all of you for being here tonight, and for those of you who are beaming in by the live stream, because your attendance at these kind of events supports our dance unit here at Colburn and all of the amazing training and performance opportunities that go along with that. Tonight is a concert, and it's an evening at the ballet, and it's a conversation. So it's a rich time for us to explore the ideas that undergird the artwork. So we're going to have live performance segments like you just saw, and then we're going to have a lot of talk, a lot of conversation, exploring the ideas that undergird the particular music and ballet that we're going to explore tonight. And it's my hope that as you all watch and listen, that you'll be refreshed by the beauty that you see and hear. And it's also my hope that whether you came more for the musical element tonight, or if you came more for the dance element tonight, that either way you would leave tonight with a greater appreciation of both music and dance. A couple of the themes that you'll hear it reiterated in the evening's proceedings are this idea of having a lifelong love for the art form, whether that's for the ballet or for the classical music that we'll hear discussed, and also a sense of both the reverence for the tradition of these art forms and an excitement about how these art forms can be renewed and how they can be revived and refreshed as new generations of artists enter into this great tradition of music and dance. And then we're going to talk a lot about virtuosity, and I want us all to think about the root word of virtuosity being virtue. It's about doing the right thing at the right time. It's hitting the right note in the bar as it was written by the composer, or hitting the right mark on the stage in the choreography as it was designed by the choreographer, and that idea of precision and virtue and virtuosity. To begin our time together, we're going to go a little bit deeper in our exploration of the ballet that you just saw, which is an excerpt from a larger work called Son de l'âme, Sounds of the Soul, by choreographer Stanton Welch, who's the artistic director of the Houston Ballet. And the music of that work is all piano pieces of Frédéric Chopin. And I would like to invite to the stage Karina González, who was one of the original cast members of that ballet, to hear more about her life in ballet, about her work with Stanton Welch on this particular work, and just her sharing a little bit of her insight into our beautiful art form. So let's welcome Karina to the stage. Karina, welcome. It's a joy to have you with us at Colburn this weekend.
Thank you. It is an honor and a pleasure to be here with the beautiful students and the musicians.
Thank you. Karina, how did your journey in ballet begin?
Yes, so I feel like I don't have a normal start because it was all by destiny, or I like to say God, or I like to also say that it was written in my book of life, just because it was all by mistake. My mother was looking for a Venezuelan folk dance school, and she didn't know the right address, so she was just asking in the street where this school was. So by chance, she just asked this person, which she always called that it was an angel, because he said that he always see kids walking by that direction, so he sent her that direction, and that was the ballet school. By luck, it was they were having auditions that day, and the director was like, "Hey, you're here, so why not to let her audition?" So that's how I did, and I got in. I was 7 years old, and I loved it from the first day.
And from being there in Venezuela in your early ballet training, how did you come to be a principal dancer in the Houston Ballet?
Yes, so it was really a blessed journey. So I graduated from ballet school when I was 16 years old, and I have the blessing to be a part of the company a couple times when I was a child, like during the Nutcracker of Coppelia. And so my dream was to just dance in my country in the professional company called then Ballet Nacional de Caracas. And so I graduated, and then I joined the company for a year and a half. And a guest teacher told the director from Tulsa Ballet, Marcello Angelini, to go to South America and open an audition because he saw a lot of talent down there in South America. So that's what he did. And he did an audition. He offered me a contract to join the company in Oklahoma, and the company name is Tulsa Ballet. So from there, of course, telling my family to just, you know, take your suitcase and go was the most difficult thing, but I have the most amazing parents that support me from day one. So I went to Tulsa Ballet for 5 years. I became a principal dancer in there, and I have the opportunity to work with the artistic director, Stanton Welch. I did two of his ballets, and I really loved his vocabulary. I loved how he used the female dancers. And so I wanted to do more of his work. I also fell in love with the ballet mistress then, Louise Lester. I felt then, you know, a connection there. So I auditioned for Houston Ballet, and I got in. So in 2013, I became a principal dancer.
Could we bring up that image of Stanton Welch, artistic director of the Houston Ballet? Karina, what are some of the ways that your work with Stanton as a director choreographer, how has that developed you as an artist in your years at Houston Ballet?
I have to say that I found that I'm very lucky to have a director as a choreographer, because he sees you work every day. He sees your strength, and then he sees your weakness, and having him choreograph on you, he uses your strength in every piece that he choreograph. I also feel that it's beautiful to have a journey, because you grow and you develop and as an artist with each piece than you do. And I feel like he really found who I was as an artist, and I think he uses that in the pieces that he choreograph.
Beautiful. Could we talk a little bit about this work, Son de l'Âme, particularly, and what was some of the background to this particular ballet?
Yes, so this ballet was a collaboration between Lan Lan, the amazing Lan Lan, and Stanton Welch choreography. So
we bring up the photo of Karina and Lan Lan.
So it was a project actually from Lan Lan. He wanted to see his playing with the dancers on stage. So we have the amazing experience to dance at the Champs-Élysées in Paris. And it was the most amazing performance that I still get goosebumps from remembering. His playing, it was incredible. But compared with other experiences, we didn't have the time to rehearse with him. So I remember we have a dress rehearsal just to hear him play for the first time. And then the performance was that night. So one of the things that we are used to is working with the pianist days before, and they kind of get used to your tempos. They learn the choreography a little bit. So they, it's a together work. So in this opportunity, we didn't have that. So, but it was amazing. I feel like make the dancer to really be present and really listen to the music and really connect with each other while that was happening.
And are there particular moments from that night in Paris in 2013 that stick with you from that performance with Lang Lang?
Oh, I have to say the bows was the most incredible experience. I think we bowed for 20, 25 minutes over and over again. And I keep saying then, of course, it was for Lang Lang, but I felt like it was for me. I was living, and I think this is one of the most beautiful things about our career is that it takes you places that I never dreamt before. So I couldn't even believe that I was there and have that experience with this incredible musician and the company.
And he was just here on this stage here at Colburn a few weeks ago doing a masterclass. It's just wild to have this connection with the ballet and with him. A little bit later, we're going to see you dance the pas de deux, the duet that Stanton Welch choreographed for you as the closing movement of this hour and a half long ballet. And are there any particular movements or moments or qualities of movement that you want us to look for when we see you dance that?
I have to say that this is actually one of my favorite pas de deux in my career because first, the music, it's so tender and beautiful. But in this particular performance, I don't think you are going to see how we ended in that performance specifically. But the pas de deux ends me walking to the corner and putting my hand on the piano. And for me, it was kind of a reverence, so thanking Lang Lang for that experience together. And I think it's a beautiful moment because it was a connection eye to eye with him, and it's kind of saying thank you for this experience. But you don't have that opportunity right now. But another thing that I want to say is that there was a lot of connection with the pianist, and I hope you can also see that tonight. And it's a team. It's two souls or three souls this time coming together, presenting this beautiful dance.
Thank you so much, Karina. We look forward to seeing that later tonight. Thank you. Thank you. In an interview about his relationship with the music of Chopin, Lang Lang said, "Chopin is not just exercise of the fingers. It's more about exercising your heart, your mind, and complete musicianship." And I think that intersection of the body, the mind, the spirit, the technique that's involved in exploring Chopin's music is why so many choreographers through history have come back to the music of Chopin again and again for inspiration. Because there's dance and there's spirit and there's emotion flowing out of Chopin's compositions. Some of the great works of ballet's history, Les Sylphides of Michel Fokine, Dances at a Gathering of Jerome Robbins, The Lady of the Camellias by John Neumeier, many great iconic ballets flowing out of the music of Chopin. And with that in mind, one of the thoughts that Karina shared with me earlier today was that as she was dancing this work, she felt that she was the music. That idea that, you know, we are the music as the dancers. And to shed more light on that, I had so hoped that we would have our inimitable professor of piano, Fabio Bedini, with me on stage tonight, but something came up, and he was gracious enough to meet with me by Zoom earlier this week. And so I hope that you'll bear with me as we just, with some Zoom quality audio, but I think that the passion that Fabio has about this music will come through so clearly. And if we could cue up the image of Fabio with Chopin as we go into this time of exploring his thoughts about the music of Chopin that we're hearing tonight. And I asked him a series of questions. We're only going to listen to his answers to a few of them for time's sake. But I want to, with the Zoom quality audio and with Fabio's great passion, I want us to listen into a few moments of that conversation. And the first question that I asked Fabio was about, what are the distinctive marks of Chopin's compositional style? And one of the first things you'll hear him say is that Chopin explored and extended the range of, among many other things, at least three of the great dance forms: the waltz, the mazurka, and the polonaise. And if you're a ballet dancer, you've spent your life waltzing and mazurkaing and polonaising in all of the classical ballets. So these dance forms are really in our bodies, and I'd love us to listen to Fabio's thoughts about that. So let's go to the first audio clip of Fabio. Thanks. So I wanted to start, Fabio, by asking you, what are some of the hallmarks of Chopin's compositional style?
Chopin was the first one to redefine what at that time, especially in the classic and baroque times, was considered agogic. The agogic has been transformed in a word that is called rubato today. The rubato is the main characteristic of Chopin in the performance style. Chopin was an unbelievable composer of three different forms. One is the nocturne form, the other one is the waltzes, and the other one is the mazurka. These three things are milestones in the piano literature.
The next question I asked Fabio was about his relationship to this particular waltz, the waltz that we saw Harper dance earlier in the program. And as we listen to Fabio's thoughts about it, it's a piece that he first encountered when he was 6 years old, and it's just lingered with him his whole life. And I think that that connects to what Karina was saying about her love of ballet beginning at age 7, and something that we've all experienced very viscerally here at Colburn, that these are really lifelong love relationships with these art forms. So let's listen into Fabio's thoughts about the waltz that we saw Harper dance and Gabriel play.
When did you first encounter this particular waltz?
I was 6. I was younger than that. It's exactly 48 years ago.
What were your impressions of the piece as 6-year-old Fabio Bidini?
I loved it. I adored it. And every time I was going for lesson, I wanted to play that waltz. And I remember my teacher said, "We already did it so many times. The waltz is done. You already played it in public. Come with something else. Why don't you come with the Berceuse?" Okay, I came with the Berceuse the next lesson. And then I said, now that I did the Berceuse, can I please do the waltz again? It makes me feel better. He said, okay. So I really loved it, that piece. I really loved it. So actually, you chose two pieces that are very dear to me.
I then asked Fabio what some of the unique technical and expressive challenges are of the waltz that we heard and of the nocturne that we'll hear in a little bit. And his description of it is so beautiful. And I want you to listen particularly when he describes the task of playing Chopin as assembling a kind of castle of paper. Let's listen to that.
Fabio, what are some of the unique challenges or nuances of each of the pieces, technically?
Technically is sound balance, is rubato, is pedaling, and quality of sound. These are the challenges that with Chopin, actually, you are always in the need of paying attention to, because otherwise you wouldn't do Chopin. It's no longer Chopin. And, you know, these are so-called pianistically simple pieces. It's like you're building a castle of paper. If something collapses, if something is not perfectly placed, perfectly in the right position, with the right dynamic, with the right phrasing, with the right, then the piece in itself collapses. It's so delicate, everything. It's so pure.
And the final question I asked Fabio, related to what I shared with you all before, is how he thinks about the dance element in Chopin's music, to which he emphatically says, these are dances. Let's listen.
And what do you ever think about the dance element in Chopin when you play Chopin or when you coach and teach Chopin?
Constantly. You cannot divide. I mean, come on, you're playing or you're coaching a mazurka or a waltz, you know, even the polonaise. These are dances. These are dances. Even, we are talking about Chopin, but Bach, all the suites, the partitas, these are dances. You can't separate. In music, there are very few things that they are written that they are not involving dance. Very few things. And only because of formal reasons and not because of other reasons. It's not true that there is not a dense feeling inside the Chopin second sonata, although it's called sonata. It's not true. The rhythmical essence of the second movement, that also can be a dance. It's officially marked as a scherzo. So it's a 3/4 in one, because scherzo is played in one. But as a conception, it's 3/4. And 3/4, again, it's a hidden. Mazurka, waltz, Lendler, it's everything.
There you go. It's as if Fabio is here with us. The last thing I want to say is just to introduce what we're going to see next. This is a video of the 6 minutes that are the second to last movement of the Son de l'Âme, this wonderful ballet that Stanton Welch has choreographed to the music of Chopin. And it seems to be the end of the ballet. What we'll see begins with a solo for Karina with Lang Lang, and over the course of the 6 minutes that follow, 15 more dancers of the Houston Ballet accumulate in energy and virtuosity, and it builds to this moment that you really think is the finish. And then what comes after that is this soulful pas de deux, which we'll then see danced live immediately following. So this is the Grand Polonaise Brilliante in E-flat major, opus 22, with Lang Lang and the dancers of the Houston Ballet in Paris in 2013. And as you watch, I want you to think about at least four marks of the Houston Ballet dancers. One, their impeccable classical technique. Two, their fluency in classical and contemporary movement languages. Three, their willingness to be collaborative agents with their director, choreographer. And four, how they immediately establish a sense of community among themselves as they dance. So let's have a look at this now. This is the final moments of the ballet leading up to the duet that we'll then see Karina and Harper dance live. Enjoy.
Thank you.
That was just exquisite. Can we give another round of applause to Gabe, Karina, and Harper? Wow. Absolutely exquisite. Last August, my wife and I went to the Hollywood Bowl for our wedding anniversary, and it was an all Tchaikovsky program. And we heard the Rococo variations of Tchaikovsky, a marvelous piece for cello and orchestra. And afterward, we talked to each other and we thought, you know, this would be an incredible ballet. And it was right around that time that Stanton Welch, Houston Ballet's director, reached out to me and asked if I would make a new work for their company. And I knew of the technical brilliance. I mean, you just saw it, the artistry, the mastery of classical ballet that company has. So I was, of course, very honored that he would reach out to me to make a new piece for the company, and thought that Rococo variations of Tchaikovsky would be the perfect thing for this company. And so I started doing more research about the piece and the way it's formatted, and it just seemed the perfect fit for this particular project. So every year in Houston, right around the start of their Nutcracker season, they do a one-off event called the Jubilee of Dance. And it's a gala where over the course of the evening, they show lots of short excerpts from the whole range of their repertory. And they have a new work usually commissioned for that occasion. And that's what Stanton had invited me to choreograph for. So he asked me if I would do something about 10 minutes long. I knew the Rococo variations was about 20 minutes altogether, so I picked a few sections of it that I thought would work well as a whole. And so I designed a ballet for four dancers, Harper, Karina, and two others, Yuriko Kajia and Nazir Muhammad, who aren't with us tonight, but you'll see them in some of the video clips that we'll show. And it's a 10-minute work that reflects the technical brilliance and expression of Tchaikovsky's composition through the technical brilliance and expression of these amazing dancers. And to shed more light on this piece of music, I'd like to welcome to the stage our very own Clive Greensmith, the professor of cello in our conservatory. Welcome, Clive. How are you? Good. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. And we have Tchaikovsky looking over us.
Wonderful.
Clive, what is Tchaikovsky's relationship to the cello?
Very important, because, you know, the cello has, in the 19th century, not that much repertoire. And we just heard Chopin. You could spend a whole lifetime just looking at Chopin's music. And, of course, there are so many others, Schumann, Liszt, Brahms, Schubert. And for the cello, we have, the late quartets of Mozart, where there's florid writing for the cello. We have Boccherini, who was a great 18th century virtuoso. We'll get to him in a minute. And then there's a bit of a gap. You have concertos by Schumann, the Brahms double, Dvorak, and then you have the Rococo variations. And apparently Tchaikovsky had been to hear Karl Davidoff, a famous Russian cellist in St. Petersburg, perform, and Davidoff bequeathed this a lot of technical study concertos. He was a composer himself and cellist, and they're not that strong, I have to say. And so Tchaikovsky took pity on us poor cellists and said, well, I'd like to write a piece for this wonderful instrument. And that's how it was born. He wrote to his brother and said he was exploring ideas, and he wanted to make it a piece that would explore the Rococo style, because he, of course, lionized the music of Mozart.
Wonderful. Mm. And what's the background to this particular piece and that Mozart style?
Well, he was a complex man, as we know. On the one hand, you have this sort of drama and passion, which is so evident in music like, you know, the Pathetic Symphony or Francesco da Rimini. And then you have the other side, which is the immaculate sense of grace and subtlety and of precision. And so he really set about working with a lighter texture for the orchestra, and a vehicle to show off the cello as a kind of elegant reimagining of the 18th century style of Boccherini, Haydn, and Mozart. And so he wrote this set of variations, which is a very typical form for the 18th century, and decided that he was going to do that with the collaboration of hoped to be Davidoff, but it ended up being a cellist called Wilhelm Fitzenhagen, who was a sort of co-collaborator in the beginning, of which, of course, had some problems later on.
And he said, "Do you know what Rococo means?" he asked Fitzenhagen. And Tchaikovsky said to Fitzenhagen, "It is a carefree feeling of well-being."
Very nice.
And then he apparently sang the melody that is the invented
yes.
Rococo theme
yes.
upon which he bases the
right.
variations. And like you said, he lionized the music of Mozart, and he took many of the Mozart piano pieces and then orchestrated them as the Mozartiana orchestral suite.
That's right.
And our Dance Academy students will be performing it on this stage in March. So
Perfect.
There's this
Couldn't
wonderful
be
connection there. And what's your personal history with this piece, Clive?
Well, it was a very formative piece for me because it's not an easy piece, as we cellists know. It's supposed to sound, as you said, carefree and elegant, but it's actually very tricky. You can't get through it out of sheer grit and bombast. It's too refined for that. It needs subtlety, and it's a piece that we have to meet as cellists. I was not allowed to play it for many years because my teacher said I wasn't ready for it, and I was dying to play it. And it became a piece that, because I worked hard at it and I revered it so much, it became a piece that once you begin to master it, it's a piece that you live with it, and it if you play it well enough, it can open doors for you because it explores the full range of the instrument, but always with elegance and precision. And then you also have the lyricism of the piece. And you're kind of, I can give you an image at the beginning in the theme. We always say that the right hand has to be the right hand of a classical composer, Haydn or Mozart, and the left hand is more of a romantic player. So it's a subtle balancing act between those two styles, and it's hard to capture. And of course, it's a piece that is quite exposed. So it's a piece that builds you as a player, and it gets you to know the geography of the instrument, rather like your dancers that need to know every single
sinew of the body.
Exactly, exactly.
Did you have a favorite recording?
I did. It was the recording by Leonard Rose, who was my teacher's teacher.
Can we bring up the photo there?
And this was the recording. It was an LP. I found it in a secondhand record store in Manchester when I was an undergrad in 1982, took it home and wore it down so it was almost unplayable. I would listen to it about half a dozen times a day, and my teacher had been a pupil of Leonard Rose, and so I was brought up with this recording as a 16-year-old.
And it's amazing because when I was making the ballet, I had started listening to the Rostropovich recording, but then the principal cellist in Houston said, "No, you have to listen to the Leonard Rose." So I actually choreographed the ballet to this Leonard Rose recording,
wow.
Not knowing any of that from your story, which is amazing. You have something to say, too, about the particular cello that you were playing by the time
yeah.
you came to learn this piece, and we could bring up
yeah.
the first photo, too.
Well, as we were chatting the other day, I was sort of taking a trip down memory lane, and yes, this is now King Charles. I'm not really a loyalist, I have to admit. I did meet him, though, and the reason I met him when he was Prince Charles in 1986 was that during this period when I was learning the Rococo variations, I actually auditioned for the use of that cello in London.
The color photo, too.
And it was a cello that was in the royal family from the time of George III, and the family had kept it. And then they sold it, and we were told that there were auditions in London, we being young cellists from all over the UK. I took the train down, and I auditioned with the Rococo variations, and I won the audition, and the prize was to get to play that very cello, there it is, in color, for 3 years. And Charles, Prince Charles, King Charles, forgive me, had played it in his dorms at university. And there's this funny story that he'd been playing along with a record of, I think it was Carrie Anne and Beethoven's Seventh Symphony. He said, "Crikey, he took it at quite a lick, he couldn't keep up." And then I met him years later, and he said he had to stop practicing the cello when he joined the Navy because his bow kept hitting the starboard side.
And I think we might even have a clip of you playing that
yeah,
cello,
we actually
Clive.
Do, could, and of course, we to my horror, you know, such a thing as the internet appeared. This is, you're going to see, this is a recording from 1986. I just turned 20, and I was an undergrad at the Royal Northern College of Music and the BBC, where they were doing these periodically televised masterclasses with a great French cellist, Paul Tortelier, and I was still using the royal cello for that.
Let's have a look at that.
In tonight's program, the music is by Dvorak, his cello concerto in B minor. It's the most popular of all concertos for cello and orchestra. Dvorak began its composition during his second visit to America, a year after the New World Symphony. But the music seems full of nostalgia for his native Bohemia, and it wasn't until he'd returned home to Prague that the concerto was finished. The first of the two cellists taking part is Clive Greensmith, and he's working on the first movement of the concerto. Clive is 20. He began studying the cello at the age of 8 with Martin Bachmann, and he's now a pupil of Donald McCall here at the Royal Northern College. During his time at the college, he's won the Barbarolli Prize and a Robert Mayer Scholarship to study in Aspen, Colorado. Last year, he was awarded the use of a cello formerly owned by Prince Charles. He also won the bronze medal in the Shell LSO competition, playing this same Dvorak movement with the LSO at the Barbican. The pianist is John Wilson.
Beautiful from Tortelli, not bad. And Clive, there's a wonderful Colburn connection to your training in Aspen.
There is, and that's what triggered this. And what happened was, I made a recording when I was 18, and it was of the Rococo variations, and it was sent to the Aspen Music Festival, and it was sent to Ron Leonard, who, of course, is the founding member, cello faculty member. There would probably not be a Colburn School without him. And I now have this wonderful job to teach, as he did here at the school. And my entrance cassette tape audition for Mr. Ron Leonard was the Tchaikovsky Rococo Variations with that cello in 1985. And that got me into the Aspen Festival. And so my relationship with Ron predates Colburn by about 35 years.
And you had said there was a bit of a genealogy that Leonard Rose
yes.
had taught Ron Leonard,
right.
who taught you, and now
and
you're teaching
teacher.
Olivia.
Exactly.
Which is beautiful.
Yeah, so it's a lovely sort of virtuous circle there.
Yeah. Yeah. Could you wanted us to listen to two moments of Leonard Rose's recording, and the first is just snatch from the theme.
Yes.
And anything you'd want to say before we listen to that?
Well, the sort of ideal cello sound to me has clarity, focus, and warmth. And we talked about the elegance and symmetry and grace of the theme, and I find that Leonard Rose does it impeccably well.
Let's listen to that part of the theme. Beautiful. You had also wanted to highlight a bit of the third variation, and what are some of the technical joys, challenges, dimensions of that third andante, sostenuto?
Well, this is where you hear the Tchaikovsky, the melodist, and also the inspiration of the dance. It's like a rather sort of slow waltz, and the cellist really has to be able to sing in concert with the other instruments, particularly in the woodwind section. And there's a parallel with ballet because you really are a collaborator with the orchestra, with the winds, as I said, with the clarinet and the oboe. And the cellist cannot pull this movement off without a beautiful sense of line, of phrasing, and of legato. And that's something the cellist has to be able to do, this kind of effortless, never-ending, I keep moving my would-be bow arm here, but it's our breath, and it's got to live, and it's got to make the notes connect, and you've got to know how to phrase and breathe so that the music transcends the instrument. It becomes just singing, and that, to me, is paramount for us cellists, and Rose does it so beautifully.
Let's listen to that excerpt from the third variation. Beautiful. With that, could we invite our dancers to the stage who also illuminate some of the choreographic process to this particular ballet? So let's welcome back to the stage Harper Waters and Karina González. And if we could bring up the next photo, it's from my notebook. There's a bit of translation that has to happen when a choreographer comes to make a new work, and that's getting the musical score set out in a series of counts that we dancers can then use to stay on the same page and stay in the same moment of music together. And so this is just a fragment from my notebook as I was preparing to go to Houston to make this ballet just a few weeks ago. That was September 26th. And on the left-hand column, you see timestamps, and those are the timestamps from the Leonard Rose recording. This is my notes for the variation that you just heard, the Andante. And I put little notes, you know, looking at the score, what the bar numbers were, and little things like 8/3 with woodwind commentary. Or if you look down at 104, at bar 126, I put conversation between the cello and the woodwinds, which is the very part that Clive was just sharing with us about. So that's just some of the homework that goes into it. And then if we could go to the next photo so you can see the creative team working on the ballet. This was earlier this fall from left to right. That's my little boy Asa and me and my wife Cassia, who's also the costume designer. And then you see the dancers. You see Harper and Karina there in the middle, and then with the pink shirt is Nazir, and then in the white tutu with the blue floral leotard is Yuriko. Those are the four dancers who will perform this work for the first time in December in Houston, and the other dancers were alternate casts. But you just see the group with our Australian conductor in his pink polo and our Japanese and Korean and American and Venezuelan. It's like the United Nations of Ballet at Houston, which is so wonderful. And with that, I wanted to ask you, Harper, could you share with us about the dynamic of constant new choreography that's going on at Houston Ballet?
Yeah, so it's I'm in my 12th season at Houston, and each year it's like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get when it comes to the new creations. And I mean, it's actually quite crazy when you showed that last slide and it said September 26th, because from then to now, I've been to Japan to perform Swan Lake with a company, and I came back to do this. And in that meantime, we worked on a world premiere by Kathy Marsden from, it's called Summer and Smoke by Tennessee Williams, the play. So it's just in those few weeks, I've done three different ballets, and I feel so fulfilled. And that's just a real testament to the work that we do at Houston Ballet. That's like a little microcosm of the stuff we do, because we're constantly, we have 6 hours a day at Houston Ballet. And each rehearsal you jump from, it's a new work, it's a new idea, you're putting on a new hat. And I guess, for example, with having you, it's a real classical work, and it was a real exciting time to revisit the classical world of ballet and to realize how hard it is. But then to have rehearsals with you, and then to jump into Tennessee Williams' world with Summer and Smoke and to create characters and have to think about intention. But it was really beautiful because I could think about what character I wanted to play in your work, even though it was just ballet steps. And with a new score and a new work, it's your first time to create something with it. And so I was so attentive to the music, and so each work lends itself to it. And so that's just a little bit of the process and joy of having such diverse and a variety of work at Houston Ballet.
That's wonderful. Karina, what are some of your memories and takeaways from the week that we had to put this ballet together?
This work is actually very interesting because normally we will work with choreographers maybe for 2 weeks or sometimes with the last piece that we were doing just a few weeks ago, she was there for 4 weeks. And so having you for 6 days to choreograph a quick piece, it was actually a different experience. But what it was lovely about it was that you were so clear of what you wanted. You were so clear with the music. So for us, it was easy. It was actually a very easy process, an enjoyable process, because you taught the steps, and then I feel like we kind of grew artistically and also technically during the process.
Wonderful. And Harper, what does it feel like to dance to Tchaikovsky? He's with us always in the ballet, Nutcracker, Sleeping Beauty, Swan Lake, Diamonds. It's a long list. What does it feel like to dance to Tchaikovsky?
Well, you know, I guess because he has such an incredible history with the art form of ballet, but I think it's also a beautiful thing to look at the cast of this work and see how diverse it is and how the landscape of ballet is really changing by who's dancing it, what they look like. And so I feel like I'm a part of history. And I feel like I love social media. I love TikTok. I love getting on Instagram, and I pay attention to the trends and the sounds and the music, and, you know, we're from Houston, so I love me some Beyonce, you know, and it's those sounds and those beats are what drive the music and what drive the trends. And here's Tchaikovsky, who's still here.
In that seventh variation.
He's still trending. He's still trending, you know, and so it's you know, the music and his work, it's just a testament of his greatness and why we as a ballet company are constantly bringing the Nutcracker back every year. The Swan Lake comes back all the time. And it's timeless because those moments of the Nutcracker pas de deux and just the White Swan pas, it's just, you can't help but shed a tear. It's so beautiful. And yeah, so I feel like I'm a part of history getting to dance it, and especially with a new work. And, you know, I haven't heard this music myself before, but it was exciting to jam out to it. And maybe you'll go viral.
Karina, what's a moment or aspect of the Rococo choreography that we should look out for as we come to watch that final performance tonight?
Yeah, so I think my favorite section is the middle part, which is the adagio. I personally love a pas de deux, and I think you made the steps and the music connect so much. There is moments when I feel like the music pull out, and then he lift me up and never stops. So I feel like my favorite part is the pas de deux. But I have to say also the last part when the music goes faster and you just add turns and speed in our steps, also beautiful. I have to say going back to classical is, as beautiful as it is very challenging. Even though when we think about it, we do ballet steps every day. Our classical class is every day, but and then you put it back in a choreography and you're like, why? This is so hard. But I think once again, we are very diverse in Houston Ballet. We do, as Harper say, so many different ballets and styles. So bringing it back is enjoyable, but also it takes us a moment to get there.
I just want to thank all three of you for your insights about the music and the choreography. Thank you all so much. Thank you so much. While Harper and Karina prepare to dance this Rococo Variations, I just want to next show you just a 30-second clip of the Japanese ballerina Yuriko Kojiya dancing her solo, which is to that beautiful theme that Tchaikovsky wrote in homage to Mozart. Let's watch Yuriko.
Thank you.
The next thing I want to talk about is the beautiful costumes that my wife Cassia has designed. We were thinking so much about that idea of reverence for the tradition and also a sense of renewal, the ideas that Harper was talking about. And so Cassia took a pretty traditional silhouette of the classical ballet tutu, but with this smoky gray color and the texture of the fabric, it gives it a very sensual, sleek, modern dimension. And she was playing around at first with doing tiaras on the ladies' heads, and she kind of kept stripping it away and stripping it away. And what she then ended up with was putting a small constellation of crystal stars into the women's hair. And then that reminded us of how we had first heard this music at the Hollywood Bowl under the stars. Let's look at the male costume. And then for the male costume, she took that kind of billowing poet shirt, like you'd see in, you know, thinking back to Chopin, the kind of romantic era ballet of Les Sylphides, of Fokine, or even what Jerome Robbins harkens back to in his ballet Dances at a Gathering, the man wearing a kind of poet shirt. And Cassia took that idea, but she made it sheer, and again, in that smoky gray color as well. So it's an infinite line and a refreshing of that traditional silhouette. Before we watch this excerpt or this performance of the Rococo variations, I just want to sort of set the stage for you. So this ballet is choreographed for four dancers, and it's a kind of portrait of each of them. Over the course of the 10 minutes of the ballet, each dancer has a solo, and both of the couples have their own duets. And you'll see Harper and Karina dance a condensed version of it. So there will be moments when there won't be any dancing on the stage, when Nazir Muhammad and Yuriko, who you just saw, would be doing their solos or would be doing their duet. And in those moments, it's an opportunity for us to just continue to have a wonderful concert and listen to Olivia and Minhe play this glorious, glorious music. And I would also say, too, that this ballet was made in the Houston Ballet Studios, which are like football fields. So we've had to compress some aspects of the choreography, but in the way that Karina and Harper dance, I don't think any of the breadth of the movement will be lost. And they'll be dancing it in simple practice clothes that are an approximation of the actual costumes, because these costumes are still being made in Houston, but they'll wear just their simple black practice clothes tonight. And I hope that as you watch, that you'll see the love and the care that each of them have taken in their devotion to this art of ballet that has led them to the level of mastery that they have, and that you'll appreciate the devotion and clarity in Minhe and Olivia's playing that's the fruit of their lifelong devotion to their discipline on the cello and the piano. And before we watch the live dance, we're going to see a short documentary clip that the media team at Houston Ballet put together, which summarizes and celebrates the work that we did on this ballet. And I hope that as you watch it and the performance of Rococo Variations, that you all will enjoy it as much as we've enjoyed preparing it for you. Thank you.
My new ballet is called Rococo Variations, Opus 33, to music of the same name by Tchaikovsky. It's a wonderful piece for cello and orchestra. And the full piece of music is 20 minutes, and I was asked to do a shorter work for this particular commission, so I've made a 10-minute version of the ballet using just a few of the variations that Tchaikovsky wrote, and it's for four wonderful dancers from the Houston Ballet. My wife and I had gone to the Hollywood Bowl, and we heard an all Tchaikovsky evening under the stars. Rococo Variations of Tchaikovsky were part of that concert with the Los Angeles Philharmonic. And as I was listening to the music, I thought this would make a wonderful ballet. It's a classical piece of music that displays brilliant virtuosity in the technique and the expression of the musicians in the same way that the dancers of the Houston Ballet are virtuosic and expressive in the classical ballet technique. I knew that I was making something for the Jubilee of Dance, which is a very special gala-type performance here each year at Houston Ballet. And in those kinds of performances, it's fun to display the unique brilliance of individual dancers. And the Rococo Variations, by its musical structure, is already divided up into those little subsections that yield themselves to being choreographed as individual solos for different dancers.
You know, although the ballet features the four of us in it, I think the true star of the ballet is ballet. The way that Silas has orchestrated the steps along with the Tchaikovsky music, these are quintessential ballet steps. And I think it created a beautiful love letter to the art form. And it made me and the other dancers want to deliver for him, because we love ballet. That's why we do it every day. We've been in this for so long, and it was a reminder of why we started. He put that love into this ballet, and so we wanted to carry that and present it for audiences, and that made it something really special.
Thank you.